Hello and welcome back to Amazing Mind. If you have just joined us, we have as our guest Dr. Andrea Polard. She's a clinical psychologist and author, and she's talking to us about her wonderful new book, one of my favorite books. It's called A Unified Theory of Happiness, an East Meets West Approach to Fully Loving Your Life. Well, Dr. Polard, we left off with how different the East and the West are in defining happiness and how we can make a conscious choice to choose happiness. What are the differences in the way that the West and the East even define happiness?
You know, happiness, as we discussed before, is kind of having a sense of our participation in life.
Yes.
And you can do that in two major ways. And the West says, do it actively. Get into a mode, which I call the basic mode. Get into an active mode and pursue your goals and your relationships. Pursue them actively and make yourself a part of life. And then the East says, don't have to do that. You can also do. You can be non-active, which isn't the same as inactive. It's not passive. You can be non-active and realize your already existing participation in life. And that's another way of feeling life participation.
That's so interesting. And so when it becomes a choice, according to the West, what type of things do you have to do to choose happiness, to be engaged?
Mm-hmm. The big overarching idea is you want to develop your consciousness so that you can swiftly switch between the non-active way and the active way of participation. And in the West, one of the ways we can do that is we need to accept life is fragile.
Yes.
And because of the fragility of life, we need to exert ourselves. We need to be ambitious. One more than the other, but we all need some. So how do we bring about ambition? We need to set good goals for ourselves. And for us not to go into the survival mode, we have to pursue these goals with the utmost integrity.
Well, you said good goals. How about money and power?
Yeah.
Is that a good one?
Right. Well, to a certain degree, we need some of it, but if it becomes it in our life, we have a problem. Mm-hmm. Then we are stuck in surviving, maybe surviving well, but not happiness. So you need to up and foremost drop your bad goals if you can. So if you have the possibility of going after a goal that fulfills you deeply, that is congruent with who you are as a person, that is what Joseph Campbell says, following your bliss.
Yes.
Yeah, that is really with who you are. And something, it brings out the best in you, then follow that. And something that speaks to you, gives you feedback. Yeah, then do that. We have way too many lawyers for wrong reasons, right?
That's right.
We have some lawyers for good reasons. If you love what you do, good. But if you really don't love what you do, you know, do something that fulfills you at least as a hobby. Pick up an instrument, you know, develop the skills that you need to do it well. And let yourself become fully alive with that.
Well, what if I have a goal of playing in the Philharmonic?
Yeah.
Then aren't I, and that's my ambition, aren't I destined to be unhappy?
You know, your goals have to be commensurate with your ability.
Okay.
So if you have highfalutin goals that make you feel unhappy, that are fantasy, not a good idea.
Uh-huh.
You need to be aware and honest about what you can do, what is doable, and not be too invested in the outcome. It's more important to be a musician than to be a musician in a particular orchestra.
That's an excellent point. So you're attached to being the musician, but not really the outcome of the ultimate.
Right. The love for the process and everything that goes in it is so much more important than arriving. Your goal has to be somehow attainable, but the process is way more important.
I love it. So setting goals and being immersed in the process.
Mm-hmm.
What's another one from the West?
Connections. We do that very well here, or not, because, you know, why relationships are so important to our happiness, probably the most important. we oftentimes are confused when it comes to our own ability to connect. We don't know what goes wrong. So I simplified it and lay out 10 building blocks of connection in my book, and you can follow step by step. Where am I going wrong? What needs a bit tweaking? What do I need to learn? Could be a very little thing. And by learning it and by practicing it, you could fix your relationship.
What are some of the most common stumbling blocks that people find in relationships?
It's oftentimes the little things in friendships, for example. People, one important building block is validation.
Okay.
Right? I think men have more problems with that than women sometimes. They don't know what they're doing wrong. Why? I've done everything I've heard. But they don't know how to validate. They listen, but they don't validate. So you need to make sure the other person understands you've hurt them. And you do that by nodding, by smiling, by saying, oh, I hear you. Oh, I understand you said this and that. And that's a very easy thing. Other person feels understood and the relationship flows.
That's such an interesting choice to validate. Mm-hmm. So we have setting goals, being immersed in the process, and then building relationships.
Yes.
Those are good from the West. What do you got from us from the East?
You know, in the East, we get to experience the strength of life, the opposite of the fragility of life.
Yes.
You know, life goes on and on. Existence creates itself without hesitation, without interference, without planning. We don't have to do anything at all. And we can lean on to that. How can we do that? Well, the first thing we need to do is open up like a flower.
Yes.
Yeah. And we have to become soft and receptive to the strength of life. Can I do a simple meditation?
Well, we got a bunch of hypnotherapists. I don't see why not.
So it's the resurrection meditation by Thich Nhat Hanh, who's a Zen Buddhist. And it starts with, like almost all meditation starts with a straight back. And you can close your eyes or keep them half open. And then you breathe in deeply, and you breathe in, out deeply, and you connect with your own consciousness. You become aware of your awareness. And as you breathe in, you can say to yourself, I am alive. You breathe out, and you say to yourself, and I smile to myself. Breathe in, I am alive. Breathe out, and I smile to myself. And if you practice that on a daily basis for a little bit of time, it opens you up to the strength of life.
A lot of people in this century have trouble sitting down and really meditating. Do you have to do it for 30 minutes a day?
That's very threatening. We have very busy lives. You know, some of us can do that, some cannot. The most important is to find a little sanctuary, a little area where you can become still. Take that time for yourself. Do it for 1 minute, two or three in the beginning.
Yes.
Sometimes becoming aware, starts with 30 seconds. And then you build to a minute, to 2 minutes, until you can do a little bit more. But you should not overdo it, and then you become disgusted with the whole process, you know.
Oh, I hear you. And yeah. I like that some's better than none. And you never sacrifice the good for the perfect.
That's right.
You know, Dr. Polard, I know everybody is going to want to buy this book, A Unified Theory of Happiness, An East Meets West Approach to Fully Loving Your Life, because it is so accessible. You have questionnaires in there, you have exercises. It's very easy to access and to actually put into practice some of the philosophies and the theories that you described.
Mm-hmm.
I want to thank you so much for being on my
pleasure.
Show, Amazing Mind. Thank you. But it appears that we're out of time for today. We all want to thank Dr. Polard for sharing her experience in her amazing book. And I want to thank you at home for watching the show. I hope you'll join us next time when we meet more people and continue to explore the amazing mind. Please stay tuned. We have a lot more coming up for you on HMI Web TV. That's Hypnotherapy Television 24/7. Thank you so much. That was amazing.